Hi, this is Diego from SideCartridge. In this video, I will take you through the history of the evolution of the TOS for the Atari ST. We will start with the official TOS versions from Atari, explore the various customized versions, and end with the community-developed EmuTOS. And also, I will run performance tests to see how they perform on real hardware using the SidecarTridge TOS Emulator. While any user can test these customs TOS versions on emulators like Steam or Atari, we're going to use real hardware with the help of our infamous device. There's nothing quite like the authentic experience of the real hardware. So, let's get started. We will start in the mid-80s, a wild and untamed frontier in the world of personal computing. At the heart of this thrilling drama is no one other than Jack Tramiel, the former head of Commodore. Jack Tramiel is credited with saying business is war, which I think it defines himself very well. When everyone was marveling at their shiny new 8-bit computers, Tramiel decided it was time to shake things up after being kicked out from Commodore. So he bought Atari and decided to build a new shiny 16-bit computer, the Atari ST. The new computer needed an operating system, so he turned to digital research. Digital Research Incorporated is the company that brought us CPM, one of the most popular operating systems of all time, which Gary Kindle developed. TOS, short for the operating system, not very original, was a blend of Digital Research Graphical Environment Manager, or GEM, and CPM. One of the best whispers around the digital campfire suggests that TOS actually stands for Tramiel Operating System, because nothing says I'm the boss like branding an entire operating system with your name. You will have to love this guy. The first version of the TOS came in floppy disk, but the early machines with 256 or 512 kilobytes of RAM did not leave enough space for the programs, so the TOS found a new home in ROM chips. This is how the original TOS version 1 was born in 1985. This pioneering TOS version faced quite a laundry of list challenges, most notably the 192 kilobyte limitation, but these problems were eventually addressed in the Atari ST, but let's not jump ahead. I can't even imagine the huge effort required for the TOS programmers during that era as they tried to cram a fully functional TOS into just 198 kilobytes. They couldn't drop a single function, they have to wrestle with inefficient compilers at that time, and also they didn't know very well the CPU. And for the kicks, they have also need to add hard disk support, which by the way didn't include it in the first version. In order to fit all that functions into the TOS, they use a sneaky trick known as line F, but more on that juicy detail later. Now let's talk about the TOS version 1. It's slow, riddled with important bugs, and what about the documentation? The fact is contradictory or flat out non-existent. These are probably just teething issues that will be addressed in the future, yes, but since the TOS was stored in ROM, fixing them was a delightful exercise of frustration. But just how bad was TOS version 1 oh really? Sure, it's legendary for its charming quirks like the 44-bit limit or the slow disk access, or when it wasn't refusing to work at all, of course. But what about the GEM interface? Well, it was slow. But just how slow compared to others? Well, let's dive in and find out. We're going to run some benchmarks comparing the TOS version 1 to the latest available for ST and Mega ST, that is TOS 1.04. We are going to use the GEMBench tool from Exos. This tool was designed to mess up performance, but I personally use it to stress my test devices. Alright, I will speed up the boring parts for you. There it is, at least a 50% dip in GEM performance and a more than 20% dip in VDI performance. That's a lot. It's enough to make it really feel when you switch between different versions or to a new version of TOS. So, why keep this TOS hanging around in your system? Simple. Compatibility. Some old games and applications were so deeply attached to these original ROMs that they throw a tantrum, or bombs, if you want, if they can find it. And let's be honest, some of the changes in the new TOS did break backwards compatibility. In my case, I'm running the SidecarTridge multi-device on every TOS version ever made, just because I have to. But let's face it, the number of people actively developing for Atari ST these days, well, is just anecdotal at the best. In 1987, Atari unveiled the Mega ST, clearly aiming for the business crowd, with its shiny new TOS version 102. It wasn't exactly a revolutionary upgrade from version 1. Apart from the bleater, an on-chip hardware accelerator meant to speed up memory transfer and graphical operations and real-time clock support, it did patch up a few bugs. Let's fire up GenBench again. Does this version only have bug fixes, or does it have something else? As I said, TOS 102 brings along support for the bleater, but I will be disabling the bleater for all the tests, since TOS 1.0 didn't bother supporting it anyway. And now we are going to launch the test and see what happens. I will fast forward through the test once more. And here are the results. It's clear TOS 102 is more than bug fixes because it addressed some of those performance hiccups in the GEM desktop interface. The numbers are pretty close to what we see in version 1.04. Finally, in 1989, Atari launched TOS 104, affectionately known as Rainbow TOS. Unlike its predecessors, this one was actually usable with hard disk. Can you imagine that? The GEM interface got a facelift and looked better than ever. Remarkably, TOS 104 even required less RAM than the previous versions, proving that someone at Atari remembered how to optimize software. They didn't stop there. Input-output management, program execution, and vector hooks all received attention. It was a commendable effort to polish the rough edges of the Atari ST development experience, but it might have been a case of too little too late. By this time, the Atari ST was losing ground to the Commodore Amiga, which was marching ahead with the superior graphics and sound capabilities. So while TOS 104 was a solid step forward, the world has already started moving on. TOS 104 was the last official version released by Atari, as they shift their focus to the new Atari ST and the TOS 106. 106 was essentially the same as the TOS 104, but without the infamous Line F hack of the early days. But of course, a popular computer like the Atari ST couldn't just fade away quietly. It amassed an army of dedicated supporters who, over the past 30 years, have created customized versions of TOS. These enthusiasts have kept the spirit of the Atari ST alive and continually enhancing and tweaking the operating system. Fast Loader TOS, I don't know if it is exactly the right name, this is the first custom TOS version that is not only changes the look and feel of the GEM, but also modifies the TOS code to allow faster application loading. It's essentially a modified version of Mega TOS 102, featuring coded patches and a distinctive and slightly creepy icons, as you can see. The performance test showed that the user interface speed remains comparable to the original 102 TOS. Chaos TOS was an unofficial, optimized version created by two indie developers, Dirk Kaczki and Andreas Konki, alias Chaos, sorry for my pronunciation. It emerged in the early 90s aiming to improve performance and functionality over the standard Rainbow TOS 104. And I think they succeeded. If you open the desktop information, the TOS name is TOS 030 with a 6804 Atari logo. Why? Because this TOS was modified to support the new Motorola microprocessors like the 68040. Chaos TOS was highly regarded for its speed optimizations. It significantly reduced boot and application loading times compared to the standard TOS, making it popular among power users, enthusiasts seeking better system performance on their Atari STs. This TOS didn't heavily change the graphical user interface, but it streamlined some system operations, leading to a snappier overall experience. It's really cool how you can jump from one window to another. Although Chaos TOS was not officially supported by Atari, it maintained compatibility with most software and applications designed for Atari ST. However, some users encountered occasional compatibility issues with certain programs that relied on specific TOS versions. But in my opinion, I think it's a pretty good TOS for a custom software. I think it's pretty amazing stuff developed by really awesome developers. Let's run some tests and you will understand what I say. Let's fast forward. Look at the results of the GM dialog box and the GM window. It's amazing. More than 60% improve over the 104 version. Crazy. Chaos TOS was appreciated in the Atari ST community for the enhancement it brought, especially for users looking to maximize their system performance. It's part of the legacy of independent development and customization that was common in the Atari ST scene at that time. EOS, Enhanced Operating System, was a £100 licensed modification of the TOS 104, developed by the same authors of Chaos. It was designed to work well with hardware accelerators of that time. Sadly, I was never able to obtain a copy to test in my lab, but it seems to be a licensed version of Chaos, aimed at commercial markets such as Germany, UK and US. Like much of the Atari ST software from the 90s, it feels like it arrived too late. If you have a ROM image and would like to share your experience, don't hesitate to reach out. Peter Paknik, alias Pepera, is one of the modern Atari legends who continues to surprise us with the impressive developments he creates for Atari ST, even in this century. This time, he achieved something the original Atari TOS developers couldn't do, fitting a TOS version inside the 192 kilobytes without relying on the line F hack that was used to reduce the size of the TOS code. He successfully ported the code from the Atari ST's TOS 162 to TOS 104 and removed the line F hack, achieving a notable performance boost. So, what was line F? The 192 kilobyte ROM space limitation was addressed by changing how subroutine calls were made on a 68000 processor, triggering an exception when an opcode started with hexadecimal F. It was a clever but dirty hack that saved ROM space at the cost of reduced performance. When the Atari ST was introduced with 256 kilobytes of ROM, line F was eliminated. But how much of a performance gain can we expect with this custom TOS? As it turns out, the improvement is significant. A 10% boost in performance is impressive. By the way, Peter Paknik offers paid custom TOS versions. While I haven't had a chance to test them, their binaries should work perfectly with the SidecarTridge TOS emulator. EmuTOS is an open source operating system developed as a replacement for the original Atari ST TOS. It is actively maintained to provide a free, modern alternative that runs on a wide variety of Atari compatible hardware, including Atari ST computers, emulators, clones, and modded systems with accelerators. EmuTOS is based on GemDOS and replicates the original TOS functionality while introducing new features and enhancements. I think some of the key features of the EmuTOS are compatibility. It works with most Atari ST, STE, TT, and Falcon software, so it's a reliable choice for running the software that you have on modern systems. It's open source. Unlike the original TOS, which is closed source, EmuTOS is freely available and under the GPL license. So there is a very active development by the community, even these days. It supports modern hardware, like it has been adapted to systems like Firebee, emulators, Atari on our Aranim, for example. And support of the platforms. Yes, it also supports Amiga. It also addresses some of the original limitations of the TOS, like memory management. It has improvements like high resolution support. It has better system performance, as we will see. And I think it plays a very crucial role preserving the Atari's legacy. The latest version is 1.3. It was released in April 2024. And it's bundled with the SidecarTridge TOS Emulator in two different versions. The 192 kilobytes version for the ST and Mega STE, and 256 kilobyte version for the STE and Mega ST. I'm going to run some tests on the 182 kilobyte version. And the results are a bit contradictory because the GEM does not perform so well, but the VDI performs over the baseline of the 104. Why is this happening? Probably because we are using the 182 kilobyte version, or maybe because most of the people that use EmuTOS has heavily modded systems with accelerators, bleater, you know, it's not the typical stock ST. But this is something that we will analyze the next part of this video, which will be dedicated to the TOS versions of 256 kilobytes. So thank you very much for watching, and stay tuned for the next video in a couple of weeks or so. Bye-bye.